Let us start again. So now we'll deal with the B splines. So it is not every day that you meet some new functions, but today we will meet a whole new collection of functions. So before I introduce the functions, let's think about which properties do you think are relevant for functions in computer-based calculations. So first of all, if you want to put something into a computer, it has to have finite support. So compact support is essential. But there's something else that you probably don't think much about usually. So if you turn on Mabel, for example, or Mathematica, or MATLAB, or any of the programs, you'll be able to take, for example, exponential functions and put into the program. You can put logarithm functions into the program, and something will come out. So it looked like the program knows these functions. But actually, everything that has to do with a computer-based calculation has to reduce everything to repeated use of just four operations, namely the plus and the minus and subtraction and addition. So everything has actually to be reduced to these four operations. So this means that even though if you put in an exponential function, what the program will do for you is just to approximate the exponential function via something that can be done with these operations. And that's exactly the reason that polynomials are so good. Because what does it mean to have a polynomial? It means to have something like a coefficient an times x to the power n plus something. But an times x to the something, this is exactly something you can calculate using just multiplications. So if you look at all the terms in a polynomial, this is something you can calculate using multiplications, and then when you add up these terms, this just means that you use the addition as well. So a polynomial is perfectly fitted to the fact that computer-based calculation can only work with these four operations. So now what we'll do today is to introduce a class of functions that simply fit perfect with this program. So there's a class of functions that is called splines. And we will not go into a detailed discussion of general splines, so I just want to define what is a spline. And a spline is what we could call a piecewise polynomial. And a piecewise polynomial means that if you think the function is defined on the real axis, it means you can take the real axis and you can split it into a collection of intervals, such that on each of these intervals, the function is just a polynomial. So maybe you have one polynomial here, and on the next interval, you have another polynomial. But no matter where you are, it is at a place where the function is just a polynomial. So piecewise polynomial means that the real axis namely, the numbers r, we can split it. It can be split into intervals. Such that on each of these intervals, we just have a polynomial. So actually, we have already seen a function of this type, so let me just state it for you. So there was an exercise some weeks ago where there was a hint about looking at a particular function. And the function you should look at was the one that was equal to x for x belonging to the interval 0, 1, and 2 minus x for x sitting between 1 and 2. And outside these intervals, we just put it to 0. So it was 0, for x not in the interval 1 to 2. So you see, this is an example of a spline, because on the first interval we have a polynomial, here we have a polynomial, and again 0, this is just the 0 order polynomial. So this is just an example of a spline. So if you think about how it looked like, if you have 1 here and 2 here, then this particular function is just the one that goes like this, and then it is actually continuous, so it goes down like this, so maybe it's better to move it a little bit like this. So this is the way the function looked like. And this is actually an example of these B-splines that I'll define now. Let's give the general definition. So now we have already defined the splines, but what we will look at today is the so-called B-splines. So the B-splines is actually a collection of functions. So this is some functions that are called n with an index m. So the m is something that is running, so m can be 1, 2, 3, and so on. So we have to define all these functions. And what we do is to define the first one, n1. This is simply defined as a function that we have looked at a lot during the last lectures, namely the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. So that's the definition of the first of these functions. Instead of just writing down the general definition, let's look at N2. And the way we define N2 is simply by taking N1 and convolve it with the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. And then we actually continue this way. That means when we want to define N3, so then we define it by taking N2, and we convolve again with the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. So this means in order to find the B-spline of a certain order, we somehow have to start with the first one, and then we construct the next, and the next, and the next, and then at the end we reach the one we want to calculate. So the general procedure here is to say that, assume that we have some B-spline given, so if you have given the B-spline nm for some integer m, then we define the spline, which is then nm plus 1. So we define the next one. And now for this definition, I would actually like to put in the variable. So we define its value in an x by exactly the same procedure as you have here. So we take the step before, we take the B-spline nm, and we convolve it with the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. And then because now I say we want to calculate in an x, let's also put the x here. So the reason that I put the x here is that in this equation I would like to calculate what we have. Here I just stated the definition, we didn't want to calculate anything, but now I actually want to tell you what it is. So, you know, you can just look at the definition of the convolution, and what this says is that we have to take an integral from minus infinity to infinity, and then we take the first function, which is nm, and then we evaluate it in x minus t, and we multiply this with the second function, the characteristic function for 0, 1, evaluate it at t, and then we integrate with respect to t. That's simply the definition of the convolution I've written down here. Now, what you see here is something that can be simplified, because we are making an integral over t, and we have the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. This means here we get the contribution 1 for the t's that are sitting exactly in the interval 0, 1, and outside the interval 0, 1, the function is 0. So that means instead of looking at an integral from minus infinity to infinity, we can simply look at the integral from 0 to 1, and then nm of x minus t dt. So what this tells us is that if you have calculated the mth order B-spline, then you can make the integral you have here And this will give you the B-spline in m plus 1 of x. Let's write down some of the convenient properties of these B-splines. So actually what I would like to do is to combine one of the theorems and one of the corollaries in the book into one statement, because then you have everything collected that is important to know about these B-splines. So we make a combination of the theorem 10.1.3 and then one of the later corollaries. So what this says is that for any choice of M, the B-splines are exactly the functions that I have defined here. I just didn't put the name B-spline in the text, I just put it in the text above. So the B-splines that we are looking at, the B-spline BM, it satisfies the following properties. So the first property tells us that we can describe exactly what is the support of these functions. So it turns out that the support of the B-spline BM, why did I call it BM here? I should call it NM. So the support of NM turns out to be exactly the same as the interval from 0 to M. So this is a little bit like we saw for these Dobezhev functions before the break, that for larger values of the parameter, the support is just getting larger and larger. So this is support, but there's an additional property that tells what happened inside the interval from 0 to m. It turns out that if we put in x's that belongs to the open interval from 0 up to m, then the function is actually strictly positive. So the picture is that if you look at a function with a certain support from 0 to m, then the function is doing something positive on the interval, and then at the endpoint it goes down and is equal to 0. This is exactly what this definition tells us. So you can already see now that we are doing well in terms of the program, because we want to do something about finding functions with compact support. And this is what we see that we get for the B-splines. We do not get it for general splines, because a spline is just defined as a piecewise polynomial. There's nothing saying that these functions have compact support. They can just change from one polynomial to the next over the entire line. So these functions do not necessarily have compact support. Here we get functions that automatically have compact support. A second property that we get out is that the integral from minus infinity to infinity of the spline in M of x, dx, surprisingly, this number turns out to be independent of M. So no matter which B-spline we are looking at, the value of this integral will always be 1. A third property that is also very surprising is that if we look at any of the splines in M and translate it, that means we are looking at its value in points x minus k, where k runs through all the integers. Then we also get something that is independent of M, and actually we get 1 for all values of x. So no matter which x we are putting in here, we get 1. Actually, if you should be completely exact at this point, there's a small special case here, because if you look at the spline in 1, you can see that this is not 100% correct. So I will add something here. If you look at the spline in 1, this is the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. So what does it mean to look at all these translates? If you say we have 1 here, and we look at the spline in 1, then this is the function that is sitting here. And remember, the way it is defined, these points are actually closed, so they are contained in the place where the function is 1, because the interval we have here is closed. So what happened when you translate these functions, you can see if you translate it by one, you end up with the function that is here. So this is n1 of x. And then what you get here, maybe I should have a different color to show that. So what you get here is the function n1 of x minus 1. And if you continue, then what you get here is the function n1 of x minus 2. So you can see, when you add all these functions, as you're supposed to do here, you actually get 1. But exactly at these points, you do not get 1, because here you are, the endpoint appears twice. That means exactly at the endpoint, you get something that takes the value 2 instead. So this means the formula that is stated here is correct, except for m equal to 1. So actually what happened is that for the case m equal to 1, the formula holds except for x belonging to the integers. But except for this special case, all of the B-splines really make the sum being equal to 1 for all x in R. So this is actually what the theorem says by itself, but I would like to add this corollary at the same time. So the statement of the corollary. So let's just put it as a straight continuation of the theorem. So let's put the numbers by capital R and capital 2. So capital 1 tells us that if you look at the function in M, then this is actually differentiable a certain number of times, namely m minus 2 times. So this statement does not make any sense if you put in n equal to 1, for example, because minus 1 times differentiable does not make sense. But already for m equal to 2, what it says is that the spline n2 is several times differentiable. And actually, yeah, I'll show you the picture in just a minute, but it turns out that the spline I showed here, this is exactly the n2. And you can see it is true, this statement, that this is several times differentiable, because there are points here and here and here where the function is not differentiable. But then already when you come to the next, already when you come to n3, which is then defined as n2, this function convolved with the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1, then you have a function which is, according to this statement, 1 times differentiable. You'll see it when I show you the figure in just a few minutes. So this is one of the statements. The second one is the one that really connects two splines, because so far it might not be clear for you that this actually defines splines, because the way I have defined splines is to say splines are functions that are piecewise polynomials. I don't think it is completely clear from this definition that we actually get piecewise polynomials out of it. But this is what the second part says, because it says that if you look at x sitting in intervals going from an integer up to an integer k plus 1, so on any small interval of length 1, then it turns out that the function in M, it is actually a polynomial. And you can actually say something about its degree as well. So the degree is at most m minus 1. So let's make a small movie here, where we say, how does it look like for n equal to 1? For n equal to 1, the spline looks like this. And you can see, this is, it goes to 1 here. So you see, this is actually a polynomial of order 0 on this interval, and then again here, and again here, and so on. This corresponds exactly to this statement. If you look at n2, then you get a function that looks like this. This is the one I already showed for you here. And again, you see, n2 We have a polynomial of degree 1 here and a polynomial of degree 1 here. So this fits exactly with the statement that we have here. And then if you go on with n3, then you actually get something that is one time differentiable. So you get something that looks like this. So let me show you a much better picture of the function. So here you see the n2 and the n3. So n3 is actually the most interesting here, and you can more or less see it, that it is made in a very smooth way here, so you actually get a function that is differentiable here, and you get it to be differentiable also at the endpoint 3. So you can see two things here on this figure. You can first of all see that it is getting more smooth when you increase the index, because here we do not have a function that is smooth. Then you go to the next order, and you get something that is smooth. You can also see what we spoke about with the support. The first one has support on the interval 0,2, and it has support 0,3, so the support is actually increasing, as the theorem tells us. Actually, I think you should spend some time just looking at this, because this is actually very surprising, this function you have here. Intuitively, when you look at a function that is smooth like this, you would say that this is probably just x to the power of 5 times something plus x to the power 3 times something plus and so on. You will think that there's just one function that you can write down, and then the graph looks like this. But this is not the case. It is really, like you see here, that whenever you look at one of the intervals from k up to k plus 1, then you get one polynomial, and then when you go to the neighbor interval, you get another one. So, in other words, I don't know if I can move him such that he point on the on the interval 0 to 1, you actually have one polynomial, and this is what you can see here. What it says is that on the interval 0, 1, you have the polynomial a half times x to the power 2. But then this ends here, and then on the piece from 1 up to 2, you get another polynomial, namely the polynomial that is stated here. But these two polynomials, they connect so well at this point here, so you don't even see that it changed from one function to the next. And again, when you go to the point that is stated here, it changes again from the polynomial you have here, and then it changes to the polynomial that is valid for x going from 2 to 3. But they change in such a smooth way that you just feel that it is one curve that is doing it for you. But you really have that whenever you're looking at an interval of length 1, it is one polynomial. When you go to the next, it is a completely new polynomial. They just fit nice together. And this is what happened for all these B-splines. Probably you know how the Gaussian look like. So actually, I did not intend to tell you this, but let me do it anyway. So the Gaussian is the function e to the minus x to the power 2. And the Gaussian actually goes from here, and then goes down like this. So if you took these B-splines and you moved them such that they were centered around the axis, then for higher values of m, they would look more and more like the Gaussian. Okay, so now we have the theorem that explains the main properties of the B-splines. I think we should do something about the proof. So what I'll do for you is actually to prove the first part. And then when you go to the problem session, you'll prove, I think it's number 3 you'll prove today. And then when you make your homework, you'll prove number 2. So one of these two is homework, one of them is for the problem session. But let's look at the proof for the first one. So I think you can guess how we have to do this proof, because we have something that is defined for all values of n of m belonging to the integers. So it looked like an induction proof, and this is exactly what we'll do. So we'll look at m equal to 1 first. And for m equal to 1, then we have N1, which is defined to be the characteristic function for the interval set of 1. So what we see is that the support for N1, this is actually the interval from 0 to 1. And we also see that N1 of x is positive for x belonging to the interval 0 to 1. And these two properties are exactly the one that we have stated here, corresponding to m equals 1. So this is OK. So now, in order to make a proof by induction, we need to assume that everything is OK for a certain value of m, and then we should prove that it is OK for m plus 1. So what this means is that we assume that for some value of the m, these properties are satisfied. So we assume that for this given value of m, we have that support of nm is equal to the interval 0, m, and that nm of x is greater than 0 for x in the interval 0, m. And then we have to prove that the same statement holds with m replaced by m plus 1. So we must show that the support of nm plus 1 is the same as, and then you see here, you also have to replace this m by m plus 1, so the support must be the interval from 0 up to m plus 1. And we must show that nm plus 1 of x is positive. And again here, the m changed to an m plus 1. So in order to do this, we need the relationship between nm and nm plus 1. So I can see I already erased it, so let's write it down again. So we actually did the calculation of nm plus 1 of x, and what we saw is that this is the same as the integral from 0 to 1 of nm of x minus t. So the first thing we must show is that the support of nm plus 1 is equal to the interval from 0 up to m plus 1. The support, to find the support means that we need to find out where is the function non-zero, and then we take the closure of that state. So let's look at some x such that nm plus 1 of x is not equal to 0. So if this is non-zero, meaning this is not 0, meaning that the integral is non-zero, so this means there must be some contributions from something inside the integral. This means there exists some t belonging to the interval 0, 1, such that what we have inside here is non-zero. So what it says is that then there exists a t belonging to the interval 0, 1, such that what we have inside here is non-zero, meaning nm of x minus t is non-zero. But x minus t non-zero, this means that x minus t is inside the support of nm. So this means x minus t belongs to the support of nm. And the support of nm is something we know because our induction hypothesis is exactly that the support of nm is equal to the interval 0m. So what this says is x minus t belongs to the interval 0m. Then we can take the t and we can add it here, and we can add it on the interval. So then we, what we get out is that then the x will be in, and the interval that comes out will be the interval from t up to m plus t. But the smallest value the t can take is 0. So this means from this side, the interval is certainly contained in something that starts with 0. And on the other hand, what is the largest value that can come out here? This is if t is equal to 1. That means the largest value that can come out for this bound will be m plus the biggest value for t, which is 1. So this is m plus 1. So actually what this says is that if we start with an x for which the function is non-zero, then this x has to be in the interval 0, m plus 1. So what this tells us is that the support of the function nm plus 1 is actually contained in the interval m plus 1. Then I know exactly what you would expect that I will do now. You will think what we need to do is to show that we have an equality here. Now we have shown one of the implications. So the next thing we would have to do is to show that this interval is also contained in this. This would be to do exactly what we have done so many times when we should show that two sets are the same. But we'll do something differently, because we will leave the statement here for the moment. And then we will show the second part. We will show this part. And then after we have shown this part, it actually implies that these two sets have to be equal. So what I'll do now is to skip about the equality that we want to get, and now I will try to get the second part. And then after that, it turns out that we have the equality here. So let's see how we can do that. So we jump a little bit, and we show that in m plus 1 of x actually is larger than 0 for x belonging to the interval 0 up to m plus 1. In order to do that, we have to fix some x. We need to take a certain value of x that is in the set. Then I claim that we can find a certain t that actually belongs to the open interval from 0 to 1, such that when we look at x and we subtract the t, then we end up in the interval 0 up to m. So you see, the statement is, I will make a small figure, but the statement is, we are looking at an x that is sitting in the interval from 0 up to m plus 1. And then I claim that we can find a certain t in the interval 0, 1, such that when we subtract this t from the x, you look at this, then we end up in the interval 0, m. So the way you can see this is actually best by looking at a small figure. Because if you have 0 here, 1 here, and let's say m is here, and m plus 1 is sitting here. What we're doing is to take any x that is in the interval from m plus 1, some x sitting here. So then there are actually two options. We can split into two cases. So one is, one option for x sitting in this large interval is that x is sitting here. So if x is in the interval 0 to m, then I think you agree with me, we can just take a very small number of t, something that is almost equal to 0, then also x minus t will still belong to the same interval. So if x belongs to this interval, there's no problem at all. We just take a very small value for t. The second option is that x belongs to the interval from m up to m plus 1. And if x is sitting here, we just subtract something to take this x and move it inside the interval going from 0 up to m. So maybe we have to subtract something that is close to 1. If you take anything here and we subtract something, a t value that is close to 1, then for sure our point will be moved into here. And this is exactly what the statement says here. So what does it mean that x minus t belongs to the interval 0, m? If you again look at our induction hypothesis, the interval 0, m, this is exactly the interval where an m is positive. So what we have found out now is via our induction hypothesis, since this belongs, the x minus t belongs to the point where the function is positive, we have n m of x minus t. This is strictly positive. But then we can go back to the expression for our function, which is stated here. The nm plus 1 is exactly the integral over this. So if you look at nm plus 1 of x, this is the integral from 0 to 1 of exactly these values. And what we know is that there are some values of t that will make this function positive. Actually, the way I have explained it here is just that we can find one value of t that makes it happen, but actually we can find intervals of t where it will happen. So what we are doing is to make an integral of a function which is positive on an interval. This will give us something that is positive. Because what we know, now there are some positive contributions, and they can never get cancelled by something that is negative, because what we know by assumption is that the function is positive everywhere. So that means as soon as we have identified some places where we get something positive, that means we get a positive contribution to the integral. It can never be cancelled by something that is negative, because this function does not take any negative values. Therefore, what comes out at the end is something that is positive. So that means this part of it will now give us this part. The only thing that is missing now is we have that the support is just contained in the interval 0, m plus 1, but we need to show that the support is exactly equal to the interval 0, m plus 1, because this is what is stated here. So can any of you explain how do we get this? So what the thing that is missing, we must show that the support of nm plus 1, that it is not just contained in the interval 0, m plus 1, but it is equal to. So can any of you tell how we can do this? Jakob?
Yeah, you can just argue that the interval 0 to n plus 1 is the smallest interval that contains the support. So if you chose any small interval, you could have x's where the function was strictly positive.
This is absolutely correct. So you say, we already know one inclusion here. We know that the support is contained in this interval. So what you say is, what happens if we believe that the support is smaller than this interval? So if you take any interval that is smaller than this, then we end up with a problem, because no matter how you make this interval smaller, there will be something left at the endpoint. But we know that the function is positive on this entire interval, because this is what is stated here, that for any x on the interval m plus 1, we actually have that in m plus 1 of x is larger than 0. So this is correct what you say. Another way to formulate it is to make a small figure, because what we have now is that for x on the interval 0 up to m plus 1, we know that in m plus 1 of x is positive. So that means, if you say we have the interval going to m plus 1 here, then we already know what happened on this interval. We have a function that goes like this. This is a positive function. So we don't say anything about the endpoints at the moment. But what we know is that the support of the function is contained in the interval from 0 up to m plus 1. That means we know that the function is 0 here, and we know that the function is 0 here. So the point where the function is non-zero, this is exactly the one that are in the interval 0 up to m plus 1. And then the closure of this is exactly the interval from 0 up to m plus 1. So if you remember the exact definition of the support of this function in m plus 1, the way we find it is to look exactly at the point of x for which n m plus 1 of x is non-zero, and then we take the closure of this set. And what we have shown is that the set of points where the function is non-zero, this is exactly this interval from 0 up to m plus 1. So we are looking at the closure of the open interval from 0 up to m plus 1, and this is exactly the interval 0 up to m plus 1. So this actually completes the proof of the theorem. Or actually, what we have done now is to make a proof of the very first part of the theorem. So what you will see at the problem session today is that to prove any other of these statements, you have to follow an idea that is very similar to what I've done here. So again, you do it for m equal to 1, and then you make an induction proof. Assuming that it holds for a value of m, you prove that it holds for the next as well. But this induction proof is more complicated than the one you should do. So the worst one is actually done here. Before we end today, I would actually like to combine the B-splines with the Fourier transform. And it turns out that because we have been working very hard for the last couple of weeks, we can actually do that in a very efficient and easy way. So how did we define the B-splines? So if you look at the B-spline in M, the way we defined this was to say this is the same as the spline before in M minus 1, convolved with the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. But how did we define the spline in M minus 1? This is by taking the spline in M minus 2, convolved with the spline 0, 1, and then again convolved with the characteristic function 0, 1. So you see, you can go stepwise down. You can start with N5, then you go to N4, N3, N2, N1, and so on. You can simply go down to a place where you just have the characteristic function convolved with the characteristic function, and so on, up to a convolution of the characteristic function. So in other words, an M is simply the function you get by taking this characteristic function and you convolve it with itself, and then you convolve it as many times as you need in order to have the function standing here exactly M times. This tells you how you can make the Fourier transform. So you remember the relationship between the Fourier transform and the convolution. It says that if you take the Fourier transform of a convolution, so now this convolution is the characteristic function z1 with itself, then the Fourier transform will simply turn the convolution into a product. So this is one of the theorems that we have seen before. So what this gives us is that we simply have to take the Fourier transform of each of these functions and then multiply them. So we get the Fourier transform of the characteristic function on the interval 0, 1, calculated. Let's put in the gamma so we can write down the function values. So let's put in the gamma at the end. So this is the first of the functions. The next one is just the same, characteristic function 0, 1, of gamma, and so on, up to the last one. So you see, what you get out here is simply that you have to take the Fourier transform of the characteristic function and then raise it to the power m. And this is something you already calculated in one of the exercises. So what comes out here is the Fourier transform of the characteristic function evaluated at gamma, and we simply have to take this to the power m. This one, the Fourier transform of the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1, you did this in one of the exercises. So what you got out was 1 minus e to the minus 2 pi I gamma divided by 2 pi I gamma. And now what we have to do is simply to take this to the power m. So this means the B-splines are very nice in the sense that you can write down exactly how they look like themselves, but you can also write down exactly how they look like in the Fourier domain. You can find the Fourier transform explicitly by this formula. And actually, the formula, I will not write it in a formal way, but what we have proven now is actually a corollary. So this is exactly the statement of the corollary, that the Fourier transform of the n-order B-spline looked like this. As soon as you see an expression of this type, you might start to think, can we connect this with the wavelets? Because, you know, in order to make wavelets, we had to start with a function phi that generate a multi-resolution analysis. And in order for this to work, we need a certain relation for the Fourier transform. So let's look at what we know about the multi-resolution analysis. And then the question is for you, is it something that we can do for the B-splines? In other words, the multi-resolution analysis is generated by a good choice of this function phi. And you see, again, this is a condition. This is something we can check because we have to calculate the Fourier transform in 2 gamma, ask if this is the same as the Fourier transform in gamma, just times a one periodic function. This is something we can easily check because we know exactly how the Fourier transform look like. So therefore, looking at this theorem and looking at this expression for the Fourier transform, it is very natural to ask, what about the B-splines? Will they generate a multi-resolution analysis? What do we think about that? So part of it is actually something that you will do today. You see, if you look at this equation, maybe you are focusing now while you're thinking, maybe you are focusing on this part of the question. You're thinking, can I show that such a function exists or such a function does not exist? Maybe this is what you're thinking now. And actually, you don't need to worry that you cannot just give an answer to that question right now, because this is actually what you'll do today. So let me show you that part of the answer. So one of the first exercises today is this 10-8. And what it shows is that actually we get an equation of this type. We can take 8-0 to be exactly this function. And you can more or less see this is very similar to the expression we have here. So you can more or less see that you have to do some manipulation with this. You have to replace the gamma by 2 gamma and then do manipulations on this expression and then pull out something that corresponds to the Fourier transform itself. And then what is left is exactly this function that is stated here. So this part of it is something that you will do yourself today. You will show that you actually have the scaling equation satisfied for the B-splines. But now we go back to my questions. And this is the one that is stated here. Will the B-spline generate a multi-resolution analysis? Now we know that one of the conditions is satisfied. The scaling equation is satisfied, namely this one. So now you have to think about either the first condition or the third condition. You know, some questions have a slightly more complicated answer in the sense that you have to say, for m equal to 523, it works. But for other values of m, it does not work. So maybe the question should be understood the way that you have to single out some values of m for which the answer is yes, and some values for which it is no. Björn.
Don't we have a problem that if we support this from 0 to m, then we won't have it to be greater than 0 always in any small interval around 0?
But this is a condition on the Fourier transform. Oh. And what you're doing, you speak about a condition on the function itself, but this is a condition on the Fourier transform.
Okay.
So actually, it was a very good comment that you had, because you started to speak about the function values of the function. But here we see that all of them go down to 0 at this point. But this is the function itself and the condition on the function that needs to be positive. This is the Fourier transform. So we need to go from the function and to the Fourier transform. You see, if you get a complicated question and you cannot answer it, the way you have to attack the question is to start to look at some special cases. So here, I'm very brave, so I ask about what happened for all the values of m. So what happened for m equal to 1? For m equal to 1, we know that n1 is simply the characteristic function for the interval 0, 1. This is the one that you know from the exercises that will generate the Haar wavelet. So the answer is definitely yes for this function. So this is the one that gives the Haar wavelet, and this is what you actually proved yourself in exercise 8.1 and 8.2. So at least for the first case, the answer is yes, but what about the other one? And I'm sure all of you are sitting there and say, I'm sure he wants the answer yes. But actually, the answer is no. And how can you see that on these conditions? If you look at one of these conditions, you can see that the answer has to be no. And it's the one of them that you can look at without any, you don't need to do any work. You just need to think about what is stated on the board. Then you can see that the answer is no. Björn.
If we translate it, then
if you translate them, you don't get an autonomous system.
Exactly. So that means this third condition breaks down. How can you see that? What happened when we look at the B-spline B2? I claim that without doing any calculations, you can see that translates of this function with itself will not be an orthonormal system. Because what happened? If I make a small figure here, we have the function n2 that is sitting here. So what happened when you translate it by 1? Then you get the function that is sitting here. This is n2 of x minus 1. So what is this inner product between n2 and t1 of n2? You see, they have to be an orthonormal system. So if you can just show that this inner product is non-zero, then there cannot be an orthonormal system, because orthonormal system would mean that no matter which two of the functions you put in, you get zero in the inner product. Here we are putting in two of the functions, so if this is non-zero, then it cannot be an orthonormal system. What comes out here is the integral. By definition, it's the integral n2 of x times n2 of x minus 1, and then in principle, there's a complex conjugation which does not play a role. So if you look at the product of these functions, it is non-zero on this small interval. And the functions you are multiplying are positive. That means on this interval, you are integrating a positive function. So therefore, what comes out here must be positive. So therefore, these functions t, k, n2, they are not an orthonormal system. Orthonormal system. And exactly the same argument, you can do the same argument for all other functions. You can see if you look at n3, it's the same when you take this function and you shift it by 1 and you multiply the function and you make the integral, you will get something positive. And because you have this property for all these in m, you always have that they are positive on the corresponding intervals. Then this theorem will tell us you can never get an orthonormal system. Now, the statement we are looking at, this is actually not something that characterizes the multi-resolution analysis. This is just a sufficient condition for a multi-resolution analysis. So you might think maybe you can find some multi-resolution analyses generated by B-spines, but just without these conditions being satisfied. But the answer is no, because even if you look at the definition of the multi-resolution analysis, you know these conditions 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then this part of the TK5 being an orthonormal system, this is a part of the definition. So since this is not satisfied here, it is not satisfied in the definition. So you can never use that definition. So the answer actually here is for m greater than 1, the answer is always no. So why do I speak about it? And why do I try to combine B-splines with wavelets when it obviously does not work? The reason is that you will have the final exercise today. And now the question is, actually, instead of looking at here, look at exercise 10, 11. Then you will see that if you do a small modification on the B-splines, then you end up with something that actually generates a multi-resolution analysis. So exercise 10, 11 today, that's the one that shows that if you do some small modification on B-splines, then you end up with a very nice class of wavelets. And this really takes these two topics and put them together. So I think you can already now see that you have some work waiting for you at the problem session. So see you there.